Next lecturer is Professor Adrian Pullian from the University, who's an expert on optical coherence tomography, and he has been very kind to us. It is the fourth time he has visited us. We are very grateful to him to have given so much to these Southern School students, and thank you very much for coming. Thank you very much for being here.
Thanks for it's a pleasure to come again. It's paradise of lasers, growing and growing. So the technology is optical coherence tomography. It will be more to do with optics, physics. It's very applied. So I'll try to have a little bit for everyone, for physicists, engineers, physicians, and those in the econometrics of delivering medical health treatment. I come from Canterbury. Canterbury is on the fast train coming from Paris and Brussels, at Ashford we have a station. So we are practically 2 hours from Paris, 2 hours from Brussels, 15 hours from London. If you come to us, we are at the top of the hill. University is the religious center of Anglican Church. Please come visit us. About the university, a few numbers. You see there that from outside the United Kingdom, there are 25% staff. They are very pro-European, despite the fact that Kent voted for leave. When you enter the campus, is written UK's European University. Despite that, Kent was on the first line of seeing massive influx of European immigrants. So that justifies, in a way, the vote, which was against continuing these links with Europe. Not against, but for the moment, they voted for leaving the United Kingdom. So over 20,000 students. Anyway, the university is pro-oriented. You see here the number of percentages of students. And there are more numbers. You like this slide. University offers a large number of grants and consistent support for those who study. it's the only university, it's the only British university which has 4 postgraduate campuses, one in Paris, one in Brussels, one in Aachen, and one in Rome. So you have to specify the university can't act wrong, the university can't act Paris. So an university, so I come from the university, can. Okay, my talk is structured along these lines. There are several methods to perform this method, which is optical coherence tomography. These are the 3 pillars of the technology: developing optical sources, optical configurations, systems, and signal processing. I'm grateful for Professor Makar giving the talk on Fourier signal processing, which is useful for understanding the way the signal is processed to obtain the image from the tissue. The technology has been applied to health, and not only to medical applications, also to non-destructive testing, as well as to art conservation and forensic art. So it's a technology which has a variety of possible applications, but the main application is ophthalmology. Optometry, something to do with the eye. Statistics from the Web of Science will show the number of reports on containing something to do with optical coherence tomography. More than 50% will be to do with ophthalmology, optometry, eye, cornea, anterior chamber, posterior chamber, retina, glaucoma, cornea, and so on. And that fields, for you to have an idea of the technology I'm going to present, here I marked with some arrows fields which are of interest for lamellas, and you'll see, of course, ophthalmology, cardiovascular system. I came here twice. Twice I was taken to this fantastic hospital where they have all CTs in cardiology. Perhaps there is a visit scheduled again. Okay, so you see that. Then you see other directions like nuclear medicine, surgery, oncology should be somewhere, pharmacology, and so on and so forth. So this will be available on the YouTube. I will also send you a PDF of this, and so you can go back and see what. So allow me to go quicker. How the technology has been put on the list of technologies for medical imaging? There was a need to image retina with higher resolution. There was no other technology to do that. And for you to understand that, let's go to a simple, very simple problem. Trying to focus an optical beam on the retina. So what do you do? If I gave you a torch and a lens, and I'm asking you, try to make the spot focused by the lens as small as possible. What are you going to do? So I gave you a torch, a source of light. Yeah? You know what the torch is, correct? Source of light and the lens. What do you have to do with the, or how should you modify the lens to have the spot behind the lens as small as possible, i.e. to address the need of the highest possible lateral resolution? What you should do? What should you do? You can have a lens with longer or shorter focal lengths. How do you think the focal length should be for you to focus better? Shorter or longer?
Short.
Good. You can also manipulate the beam diameter. How that should be for you to focus better? Larger or smaller? The diameter. The diameter of the beam from the torch towards the lens. What should you do with the beam diameter to make the spot behind the lens smaller? What is it? Large. Large. And it's connected to what Professor Magda presented because it's coming from the Fourier transformation. You go from the space which is before the lens into the space which is behind the lens because the lens practically executes roughly a Fourier transformation. So the larger the beam diameter, there is a Fourier transformation there showing that the spot is smaller. Okay, so according to the optics, to simple optics, to the geometrical optics, if you make the beam diameter bigger and if you make the focal length smaller, you should be able to focus the beam smaller. Is that clear for everyone? Can we do that? You can do only half of it. Why? Because you cannot modify the focal lens. The lens is the eye lens, and the vitreous in the human eye is 2 centimeters. So we are stuck with a 2 centimeter focal length for the lengths of the eye lens. The eye lens is in our eye, adjusted to focus at 2 centimeters. So that is fixed. We cannot change the focal. So we cannot make it smaller to increase the resolution. The only thing we can do is to increase the beam diameter. And in increasing the beam diameter, we are also limited by what? How large could the pupil be? How large? Give me a number in millimeters. What is your pupil in the dark? How many millimeters? You don't know how large your pupil is. Switch off the light and come here. You wouldn't see, that's why you don't know. It's at the maximum 7-8 millimeters. So you are also limited there. So if you do simple calculation and you apply geometrical optics, that's what I'm showing you, that if you increase the beam diameter, you can make the spot smaller, i.e. you increase your transversal resolution. Fine? And you can increase not only the transversal as well as the axial resolution, which is here. Okay? So you see, as I increase the beam diameter, I can make this interval here, in the working depths, smaller. So I can improve both resolutions, lateral and axial. Okay? However, what's happening in reality, that's what happens in reality. The eye lens not a nice round spot. And that's the limitation. So because of this limitation, I could test with the largest possible diameter to the eye. Laterally, we cannot achieve better than 15 microns. And axially, we cannot separate layers in the retina which are closer than 300 microns. And the retina in the center of the eye, where the fovea is 150 microns. So we are, with the resolution, we are even less than the thickness of the tissue we wanted to depth resolve. Okay. So the only other possibility was this one. Not to try to improve the focus of the instrument, but to do something else, to apply interference. And not only any interference, but interference with light of low coherence. What would that mean? Again, you need to recur to Professor Marcus Fourier transformation. The larger the spectrum, the more colors you send into the interferometer, the better would be the axial resolution. Because you do interference with light of lower and lower coherence lengths. And I will explain that with some sketches. So by applying this Fourier transform, which connects the width of the Fourier spectrum to the special Fourier transform, which is practically the axial resolution, we can achieve even some microns. So without playing with the eye lens, you can improve the axial resolution to levels below micro. And this technology is optical coherence tomography. It has been invented at MIT in 1991. They wrote a paper in Science in 1991 and provided sections in an image in vitro. So I'm showing it here how that technology works. So you have a source which emits a wavelength which is very short. See, it's very short. Spectrum is very large. If the spectrum is large, the wavelength is short. So because this distance is equal to the other distance, we practically superpose here two wavelengths. So a wavelength comes from an object mirror, and another wavelength comes from a reference mirror. So we have two beams, and we interfere these two beams. So I'm doing here interference. So if this optical path length is equal to the other optical path, you see when they come here, boom, we produce more signal. So as long as the optical path difference between these two is zero, you can produce a sufficiently big signal. However, if you move one of the mirrors slightly away, if you move it slightly away, what happens? The wavelength being so short, because this is longer, this one comes later, and it doesn't superpose on the other one. So you see, now I don't get that effect of overlap, of interference. So the only way to obtain that interference and maximize the effect is for this distance to be equal to that distance. So what shall I do here to re-obtain the maximum? What shall I do? To push that mirror up, to make this distance equal to that distance. And in that case, our delay, the wave train, to match the delay of the other wave train. Is that clear? So by equaling this optical path, we can superpose the time they arrive at the beam splitter. So the beam splitter divides the beam into two, they are superposed, and you can only obtain this effect, which we call coherence gating. This is a coherence gating. If one of the mirrors is slightly away from the other one, they are not matched in delay, and you don't obtain the coherence gating principle. And again, Fourier transformation, the more colors we put here, the Fourier transformation of this Gaussian is another Gaussian, which is narrow. So for instance, in the close infrared, if the bandwidth is 20 nanometers, you can get here tens of microns. So if you put more there, you can make this even some micron. So that's the idea with the coherence length. So the larger the spectrum here, the larger the spectrum, the shorter the coherence length. So that's why we call this interference with light of low coherence, because the coherence length listens to the width of the spectrum. The more colors you put in the spectrum, so the larger the spectrum, the more you go away from a pure laser. A pure laser is one monochromatic emission, one wavelength. For a laser, you have here one line for a laser. It will be a well-defined wavelength. Here, a laser wouldn't do good for this principle. And I'll show you that again. So we need to have more wavelengths. Making that larger, this becomes smaller. If you put here a laser, which is only one component, according to the Fourier transform, if that was only one single monochromatic emission, this will be very wide. So you lose the axial resolution. Your axial resolution is determined by how short this is. You want to make that as short as possible. We call that voxel imaging. The voxel is a three-dimensional pixel. You know what a pixel is. And if you, the more money you wanted to throw on the digital camera, the more megabytes you buy. Yeah. Yeah. So laterally, the lateral resolution will still be determined by the microscope, because you are this reference beam on top of the microscope. So laterally will still be determined by the microscope, but axially it will be determined by the coherence length, by this effect of interference with light of low coherence. In the next cartoon, I will show you what happens if you use a laser. So again, the interferometer, you see the interferometer there, the beam splitter, the source and two mirrors. And let's say that the source is a laser. If it's a laser could have a coherence length of hundreds of kilometers. Okay? So you move this mirror halfway length, you'll obtain a peak. You move it another halfway length. You move it halfway length, but the ray travels halfway length, another halfway length, so in total is one wavelength. So from here to here, you have a 2 pi. Another 2 pi, another 2 pi, another 2 pi. So by moving this every halfway length, the wavelength is what? Let's say that it's 1 micron, near infrared. But every half micron, you re-obtain a peak, a peak, a peak. And you can do that for 100 kilometers. No way to obtain depth dissolved capability. Okay? If it's a laser. So what you need to replace the laser with a broadband optical source. In which case, if you use a broadband optical source, in that case you only obtain interference within this. So if in between these you have half wavelengths, how many do I have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, let's say 15. 15 times half micron, you get about 8 micron axial resolution. By replacing the laser with a source which has sufficient broad bar. Let's now complicate things. Let's go to tissue. Let's go to a glass plate which has two layers in between. Air, glass, glass, air. So you have two interfaces here. Air, you should know, even the clinicians, what an index of refraction is. You may have. How do you define the index of refraction? How do you define the index of refraction? I shouldn't ask the physicist. What is the index of refraction? Is the ratio of speed of light in the material, okay? So is the ratio of the speed of light in vacuum over the speed of light in the tissue, okay? So in air, that's 1, it's close to vacuum. In water, it's 1.33. In glass, it's 1.5, okay? So the denser the material, the larger this index of refraction. So let's say you go from 1 to 1.5 and this 1 again. So as I move that reference mirror and I approach the situation of optical path difference for this interface, I will obtain those 15 pixels. From here to here I have 1 millimeter times 1.5 in glass is 1.5 millimeters. So when I move my reference mirror 1.5 millimeter, I will go again with this bridge pattern in time. Now we use a new power supply for the iPhone. Do rectification. Okay. You do rectification of this, so you obtain only pulses up. You do an analog filtering, and you obtain two peaks. This peak will identify the presence of that interface, and this peak, the analog of this, will identify the presence of this other interface. So you have two peaks. So in this way, you identify the true object has two interfaces. Tissue has many interfaces. So in the same way as I did with a glass plate for macroscope slide, 1 millimeter thickness, in the same way you can do it with skin. You will obtain a peak on the stratum corneum, another peak on another layer inside, and another one, another one, another one. So you obtain that, what we call it, how many have played with ultrasound? How do you call reflectivity profile in depth if you use the ultrasound machine? Now, I expect the clinicians to know this. It's called an, no one has used an ultrasound machine here. It's called an A-scan. No one heard about A-scans? So, in ultrasound, reflectivity profile in depth is called an A-scan. So, let's conclude. There are three main parameters of the optical coherence chromatography. The first one is this one, is the axial resolution, which only the OCT can do it. And we refer to that. It's given by the coherence length, so the larger delta lambda, the better the resolution. Coherence length is less and less. The second one is the parameter which is not that good for OCT. Why? Because it's based on, OCT is based on interference. So you need the beam coming from tissue, which is multiple scattered, goes through the skin, goes through the eye, goes through the retina, and there is another beam coming from the reference mirror. So these two have to interfere. So the only way to get interference is if the phases are well controlled. If the photons going into the tissue are scattered more than once, the phases crumble, and the two waves cannot interfere. That's why optical coherence tomography relies on single scattered photons. You can only get interference if the photons have been scattered. If this photon has been deceived going inside the tissue several times, more than two is sufficient, or at least two is sufficient to lose the phase. And in that case, when it comes back, there's no interference with the beam coming from the reference mirror. So because of that, the single scattering photons used by OCT limit the penetration depths. And that's why OCT is limited by a couple of hundred microns to a few millimeters, depending on how large the scattering is and the absorption in the tissue. This third parameter is a good one for you because it's something which you don't have it in normal microscope. In normal microscope, you send light to the tissue and you amplify it as much as you can to get the signal. Okay? So you rely on your signal returned by the tissue. Here in OCT, you can take advantage of the powerful signal from the reference mirror. It's like you amplify this weak signal from the tissue with a powerful one because you do practically interference, which is a product. Is the product, if you look at the mathematics of interference, is the product of this weak signal from the sample, from the object, from the tissue, with the strong, powerful signal from the retina. And that's what explains the sensitivity of OCT in comparison with confocal microscopy. If you compare confocal microscope for skin with that of an OCT for skin, practically the penetration depth is at least 3 times more because of this, let's call it amplifying. Like with any medical imaging modality, there is a clutter of terminology. Now, the letters A and B come from ultrasound. So a reflectivity profile in depth, you'll find it in ultrasound machine. How the ultrasound works, you set the pulse, and you look at the timing of arrival. Here we don't look at the time, we do this coherence gate. But in principle, we do something similar. That's why in many books and papers, you will find some analogies. But don't work on those analogies because you should stay away from saying that OCT is like ultrasound. The effects are, the way things are happening, are totally different. We don't measure any time of flight. We rely on the coherence gate. So, A scanning is a reflectivity profile in depth. You found a peak, another peak, and so on, as many peaks as you have in the tissue. More here, so that's an A scan, correct? A reflectivity profile in depth, like an ultrasound. If you do that for every pixel in the lateral direction, you get a B scan, cross section. A cross section through the tissue here, so cross section this way would be a B scan. Again, B scan comes from ultrasound. However, we can also produce what we call it, that's what we do in microscopy. When you change the focus in microscopy, you get a constant depth image. Change the focus, another constant depth image. And you have letter C there. C, system. From size, and now we can produce a viscum for many T-scans with depths, or we can produce a C-scan. So if this is a long X, you repeat it a long Y, and you obtain a C-scan. So T-scan allows you to obtain both viscums and C-scans. While if you use A-scans only, you cannot produce a C-scan. With A-scans, you can only produce viscums. That's all. I hope that is everything. What is OCT in comparison with the other competing technologies? In terms of penetration depth, there's no way to compete with ultrasound. If you use low frequency ultrasound, you can go in penetration depth to centimeters. And clinicians still use ultrasound machines, for instance, to look at how long is the eye. And in that case, they use low frequency OCT. Okay? Now, if you wanted higher resolution, low frequency ultrasound. If you wanted now high resolution ultrasound, what do? We increase the frequency, but when you increase the frequency, let's say 15 megahertz ultrasound machine, your penetration depth is going to go to a few millimeters. And at the best, you obtain 50 microns to ultrasound resolution. Confocal microscopy, on the other hand, will give you some micron resolution, but penetration depth is also limited. World confocal microscopy is practically for single layer cells tissue. You won't see confocal microscopy applied to anything thicker than a few hundreds of microns. And OCT now is somewhere in between, and with the last evolutions in optical source for OCT, now practically we have now broadband sources which emit a single cycle of light. So practically the bandwidth is similar with the central layer. The bandwidth is similar to the central layer. So in this case, this number comes down here. So OCT now can reach some micron with these sources. This is the first image published in Science by a specialist at MIT. We invented the TEM. They had this fantastic idea of coin step, which stayed that way from the very beginning. And that was the launching time of evolution in this technology in 1991. You don't see much, but you see sufficiently to identify layers in the retina. So as I told you here, the retina is 150 microns. Good. So now, that's an image which modern technology produces. That's one image with our systems. Ophthalmologists know where each of these layers is. And they practically look at this is a viscum image from the retina. You even don't need to dilate the eye. You don't need to dilate the pupil. It's instantaneous. You don't need to wait like in CT, in MRI. You don't need to wait for reconstruction. Place the patient, adjust the chairs, look through the eye, and you get that instantaneously. So from visit to visit, ophthalmologists are used to look at what's happening in the eye. So there are three major diseases of the eye. Can anyone list those three diseases? What are the most? What is cost on NHS to go to three diseases in keeping our eyes healthy?
Glaucoma
is one. In glaucoma, so the photoreceptors are here in the macular region, and this, you see this bump? This is the nerve fiber layer. Due to the pressure in the eye, so the vitreous is here, so you should image. So this is 150 microns, this is about half millimeter, and the eye, the vitreous will be 2 centimeters, will go to the ceiling. That's the way you should see it. Fine. So due to the pressure in this big sphere above, the nerve fiber layer gets thinner, so that is glaucoma. Electrical pulses from the macula are taken to the optic nerve, the sum of it. So that is what is glaucoma. The vision is lost from the periphery to the center. There is another major disease which starts from the center, and that is called HAP. The other major disease is age-related macular degeneration. What macular disease? AMD is called. So this happened here. So fluid accumulates here, and this part of the retina inflates up. And you can see here a distorted retina. And the other third disease is, which is the other third one, diabetic retinopathy, where you see all sorts of accumulations of deposits in the retina, which are well identified by the OCT. So the power is safe, you can stare as long as you wanted, not as long. The standards would say that time should be limited. But this is the most popular wavelength for less than 1 milliwatt, as long as the beam is scanned. So the eye pupil is very safe. And now there are many, many OCTs and many companies producing systems for the retina. Image from the cornea, from the anterior chamber, you see here, this is the eye lens. So there will be this is about 6 millimeters, and the vitreous is here. That's the lens, that's the cornea. Okay, so you see that axially with 5-7 microns. More resolution in the cornea, you see even nerves in the cornea. And that will be a movie without technology. Taking these scans as you go, so that's the eye. So I go with the scan. So now here is the eye lens. So that's the iris. So at some point you see the maximum opening. And as we go into this scan, we go to the other extremity where this will join back. Okay. The 3 OCT methods. That's the first method, the time domain, and the one which I explained based on the limited coherence length. So you have a broadband source, an interferometer, that's the tissue, and the reference mirror. So light interferes to eliminate the off-axis rays. You use a pinhole, and of course you need here a microscope to convey the image to an image device. So these are the ingredients for the OCT. So initially in 1991 until 2000, OCT evolved based on this basic technology. Michelson interferometer, simple. And we call that time domain processing. However, the most modern technology is this one. What is the change? I change the broadband source with a tunable narrowband laser. Now it's a laser. However, to re-obtain that axial resolution, I should tune this laser in the same broadband tuning bandwidth as before. So if my bandwidth before was with a broadband source of, let's say, 50 nanometers, as long as I tune it within 50 nanometer, I re-obtain the axial resolution of a couple of microns. However, this method allows us to go much, much, much faster. And if you apply Fourier transformation of the spectrum, you obtain all the A-scan in one Fourier transformation step. I'll show you immediately. So this is called swept source OCT or Fourier domain OCT because it's based on a Fourier transformation. And the most modern technology and the largest number of commercial systems for the eye will use this technology. So we put the broadband source back, but we don't use a photodetector like before, we use a spectrum. So practically, what you see being used here is the spectrum. The spectrum coming out from the interference of these two, I'm looking at the spectrum with a spectrometer. So if I look at the spectrometer and whatever I get out from the spectrometer, I do a Fourier transformation, I obtain this scan. So I will show you that in here. So these are the two modalities of what is called today spectral. This will be called more spectral, and the other one is the tuning laser Fourier domain. Both are spectral domain processors. These are the two which are the most modern now because they produce an A scan via a Fourier transform. So you see here the interferometer from the tuning laser. You have one beam going to the sample, the light comes back to the interferometer. Light goes to the reference pass and that creates the other beam. So they interfere here and you have a photodetector, a tuning laser. Here the same, that splitter there will be like the splitter in Michelson, broadband source this time, the two mirrors, and the light comes back, superposed, and you look there at the spectrum. So you look at the spectrum coming from the interferometer in the same way you look here at the spectrum in the same way. Let me explain you that these two are equivalent, that in fact, in the same subsocially in the spectrum. So let's say that we created an optical path difference of a couple, let's say that the coherence length is 10 microns. Okay? Let's put those two mirrors at 30 microns, easily. Okay? If you look at it, if you take an optical spectrometer and you put it there at the interferometer output, you will see this number of peaks. Okay? So that's the optical spectrum. Now if you use a spectrometer, you build it with a diffraction grating or a prism and a linear camera. So practically you can produce an electrical signal which is proportional with this spectrum. So if I now use a tuning laser, which is very, very narrow band, and I tune it, in time I will get a signal. So now I transfer the optical spectrum into a temporal signal. Practically I read the spectrum. So instead of using a spectrometer, I can read the spectrum in this way, very elegantly. See, that's why the subsociality is easier today and offers, I will show you that it offers the fastest scanning capability and so on. Let's say now that you increase the spectrum. In that case, the optical spectrum will be channeled with many peaks, like let's say it's 80 microns. Difference, optical path difference between the two mirrors. Now if it's 80 micrometers, when I read it with my narrow laser, I will get a higher radio frequency in the photodetector. So let's say that I read that at 1 megahertz, that is 1 microsecond, with how many peaks I'm here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, it's like I generated here 7 megahertz. How many peaks are here? About 3-4 times more. So instead of 7, they will do 50 megahertz. So looking at the frequency of this, I can tell you what the optical path difference was. It's like you encode the optical path difference on the frequency of the red signal, which is red by that one photodetector. Now about optical sources. So what we need? We need either broadband sources, or we need fast tuning lasers within large bumps. There are all sorts of, if you look into reports of OCT, you'll find these. Many superluminescent diodes put together create a large boundaries. The time is a fire later, emitting short femtosecond sources, but broadband. And the most modern source is that given by photonic crystal fiber, which goes into hundreds of nanometers. We work together with multi-wave photonics to produce a broadband source for the 1 micron wavelength, which is now more and more favored for imaging the retina. And we put together two sources to increase the boundaries and to address shifting from these wavelengths, the most commercial systems for the eye here, for the retina, to shift here in this gap, 1060 nanometers. Why would we prefer to go here than here? If you look into the theory of tissue optics is called, the longer the wavelengths, less is the scattering in general. And because the ingredients in tissue are generally similar to the wavelengths of large. This type of scattering is called mis-scattering, and its intensity decays, or it's almost constant or decays with the wavelength. So by using a longer wavelength, we can penetrate more. So after clinicians saw these fantastic images from the eye produced by 800 nanometer OCT systems, they wanted to see more in the choroid. Choroid is just below all those multiple layers in the retina. They want to see more there because many bad things happen there. So we wanted to have penetration. So the only way to get penetration is going longer. But what happens, the water absorption, as I told you, the vitreous is 2 centimeters. So the light goes 2 centimeters and has to come back 2 centimeters. So it's 4 centimeters of water that you absorb. And you see, that's the curve of water absorption. So the only chance for us to increase wavelengths is to work in that crater that deep. And that's the source we build, and we obtain 7 microns. You see the axial resolution. And this is a comparison of two images produced at 800 nanometers and at 1 micron. You see here, that's in the corridor, we can see more. See here? And now there are more and more companies producing all cities for the Arctic. They move their central windmills towards 1069. Interesting for this technology is the fact that it admits combinations with other optical modalities, as well as other non-optical modalities. And you see all sorts of reports combining confocal with OCT, fluorescence, Raman, coherence. This is CARS, this comes from Stokes and anti-Stokes, Raman scattering. And sound, ultrasound, and X-rays, like examples with non-optical modalities. And I have time to show you an example with combination with optoacoustics, which is interesting. Now, in terms of broadband sources, you should have a look at these sources coming from, there are three companies in the world making that. The largest is NKT in Denmark. The supercontinuum as a principle appeared in 1999. And you should compare it with OCT.